Hello students, once again welcome in our video lecture series for class 11 economics. Today we will discuss chapter 3 of the book Indian Economic Development. The name of the chapter is Liberalization, Privatization and Globalization. In our all lectures related to this chapter, we will call these three terms together as LPG. L for liberalization, P for privatization and G for globalization. Let's start. The last chapter which we did was Indian economy during 1950 to 1990. We discussed in that chapter that since independence, India followed the mixed economy framework by combining the features of both capitalistic economy and socialistic economy. No doubt, during 1950 to 1990, India grew and developed a lot. India's industrial sector became more diversified and produced the variety of goods at home. Due to several reforms in this sector like licensing, concessions, importance to small scale industries, etc. Not only industrial sector improved, but also the agriculture sector due to several reforms like land ceiling, regulation of rent, abolition of intermediaries, consolidation of land holdings, cooperative farming, green revolution, credit facilities, irrigation facilities, minimum support price and organized marketing system. Output expanded, which ensured the food security. India became a self-sufficient country in food production. And not only this, foreign trade policy was also formulated to protect domestic industry and keep balance of trade in manageable limits in the form of import substitution. All these policies continued for decades, but it was noticed as early as in 1980s that there were many shortcomings which our Indian economy was suffering from. For example, fiscal deficit. Fiscal deficit means excess of government expenditure over government revenue, resulting in heavy government borrowings known as the concept of national debt. Prior to 1991, fiscal deficit of the government increased too much due to increase in non-developmental expenditure of the government. Because of this, Indian economy was in a debt trap. Second shortcoming which Indian economy was suffering was adverse balance of payment. You know, balance of payment is the difference between inflow and outflow of foreign exchange. Before 1991, exports were less due to poor quality of domestic goods and imports were high despite of heavy tariffs and quotas. The third problem of Indian economy was inflation. Rise in prices. Can you imagine, the rate of inflation was 16.7% in 1990-91. Such a high rate reduced the demand of Indian goods in domestic and as well as in foreign markets. Next shortcoming, that there was growing inefficiency in the use of resources. That is, the resources of Indian economy were not used efficiently and properly. Not only this, over protection was being given to the industry. Also, there was mismanagement of firms and the economy. Public sector. The losses of public sector undertakings were rising up to the heights of a mountain. Next problem faced by the Indian economy was various distortions like poor technological development and shortage of foreign exchange reserves. Can you believe that the government was doing imprudent borrowings from abroad? On the one side, there was shortage of foreign exchange reserve, and on the other hand, available foreign exchange reserve was not being properly utilized. That is, foreign exchange reserve was being mismanaged. Last but not the least, the major problem was of inefficient management of the entire Indian economy in 1980s. It was due to lack of finance, defective policies, and inefficient administration. So, realizing all these drawbacks, economic reforms were set in motion in 1985. However, these reforms were also not proved to be of much importance. Therefore, new economic policy NEP or new economic reforms were set in motion in 1991. Or we can say that above mentioned economic crises are responsible for the birth of new economic policy 1991. This new economic policy changed our developmental strategies. In this chapter, we will study about economic reforms since 1991. As we know, despite our best efforts and economic planning, India still stands amongst poor countries in the world. The quality of India's industrial product is still comparatively low in the world. The thought behind the reforms was towards creating a more competitive environment in the economy and to remove the barriers to the growth of economy. This economic policy is called as new because it measures just opposite to the economic policy prior to 1991. This new economic policy involves mainly three economic reforms to speed up the pace of our economic development, and these three economic reforms are L for liberalization, P for privatization, and G for globalization. Also, this economic policy can be divided into short-run measures, also known as stabilization measures, and long-run measures, also known as structural reforms. Actually, short-run reforms focused on two objectives: to bring inflation under control and to improve balance of payment. Whereas long-run measures focused on improving the efficiency of economy and increasing its international competitiveness. So, students, let's start with privatization, one of the three reforms. Privatization, it means transfer of ownership or transfer of management of a government-owned enterprise to the private hands. Prior to 1991, public sector was given greater degree of priority and importance, but the desired result could not be achieved by the performance of public sector undertakings. This new economic policy aims at expanding private sector by removing strict control over it and making it free to innovate and progress. Government also tried to improve efficiency of some public sector companies by granting them special status of Navratans and Miniratans. These were given greater managerial and operational autonomy in various decisions to run the company effectively. This privatization can be done in two ways. Number one, by withdrawal of the government ownership and management of public sector companies and transfer of ownership to the private sector. And secondly, privatization can be done by outright sale to public sector companies. Privatization of the public sector undertakings by selling part of the equity of public sector undertakings to the private sector is known as disinvestment. It means disinvestment is a part of privatization. The purpose of privatization is to improve financial discipline, to facilitate modernization by encouraging private sector to invest and participate in economic development with their administrative efficiency. Positive impact of privatization or the benefits arised from privatization. First argument in favor of privatization is that it improves the efficiency of management. Privatization makes the entrepreneurs free to make quick decisions without interference by the government, that is better decision making. Second benefit of privatization is diversification of production. Private sector functions efficiently to satisfy the unlimited wants of consumers in order to create a market for its production. Privatization results in diversification and expansion of production. Privatization also promotes consumers' sovereignty. As we know, consumer sovereignty means that consumer is the kingpin of the market. Consumer sovereignty means producers are pressurized to produce that commodity which is demanded by the consumer. Third benefit of privatization is increase in FDI, foreign direct investment. Privatization provides strong chance to the inflow of FDI as financial discipline improves in the country due to the capital invested by the private sector. Other countries like to invest here because of expanded domestic market. Fourth benefit of privatization is competitiveness. Private capital and managerial capabilities could be effectively utilized to improve the performance. This would further encourage competitiveness in domestic as well as international markets. It helps in making PSUs, public sector undertakings, more competitive. Next benefit of privatization is financial discipline. Earlier, there were undue delays in sanctioning of funds due to complexities in the administrative setup. It was the privatization which maintains financial discipline by regular supply of funds. Next benefit of privatization is reduction in deficit. See, privatization helps in reducing the burden on government reserves, which result from the public subsidizing of chronically loss-making public sector undertakings. Privatization helps in reviving sick units, which have become a liability on the public sector. So, this was the positive side of privatization. Now, its negative side. Neglect of social interest. Private sector functions mainly with the objective of profit maximization, which may be done at the cost of social welfare of people. Thus, a socialistic pattern of society may just be a dream reality, as social interest is not the primary objective of the private sector. Second demerit of privatization is high-priced goods. Privatization functions on the basis of market mechanism. When prices rise, demand by those who cannot pay this price would fall. And if it continues, this may become a major problem of inflation. And if inflation is not controlled, it may affect the majority adversely. Third demerit is creation of monopoly. Privatization, if remains uncontrolled, may turn into monopoly, where private owners may have monopoly control over the market. And if this monopoly power continues, it may result in concentration of economic power in few big hands. It may result in lopsided development of the industries in the economy. Fourth demerit. Privatization does not work towards achieving the objective of full employment, as it is guided by profit motive. And in order to cut down cost, it may cause retrenchment and consequent unemployment. That is, privatization increases unemployment. Next demerit. Privatization in many public sector undertakings resulted in voluntary retirement of many workers because of unsatisfactory job conditions laid by the private sector. It will further increase greater disparities in income and wealth. After considering the negative side of privatization, we can conclude that privatization offers both opportunities and threats to the economy. Due to threats of privatization, should we leave it? Should we not go for privatization? No, this is not so. We have to privatize in such a manner so that we make the maximum of opportunities and at the same time minimizing the threats or challenges to the economy. So, students, it all was for today. Let's revise what we have done today. We started our chapter with the performance of various sectors during the period 1950 to 1990. It was quite satisfactory in respect of agriculture, industry and trade. But still there were many problems in the development of the Indian economy, due to which economic reforms were set in motion in 1991 and named as New Economic Policy, NEP. The main features of this policy were liberalization, privatization and globalization. Today we have done one of them, that is privatization. privatization means transferring the public sector enterprise in the hands of private sector, so that the efficiency of both the sectors may improve and the many loss-making public sector undertakings which have become burden on the economy may be revived. Then we did both the advantages and disadvantages of the privatization. In our next lecture, we will do the second economic reform in the nature of liberalization with its various features. Now, thanks for today.